War is hell. It's the time-old phrase of nearly every modern historical war film in existence. Saving Private Ryan, Apocalypse Now, Black Hawk Down, Platoon, and All Quiet on the Western Front are just some of the most notable war stories that happens to share that phrase as their theme. Now I can safely say that we can add another sure-to-be classic to that list of great war films. Only this one has a unique distinction of having a quotable phrase of its own. War is a drug. This is the Hurt Locker. Freelance journalist Mark Bull was sent to write an article about the daily life of bomb disposing in Baghdad just a few years ago. Mark, moved and shocked by the experience, wrote a feature-length screenplay instead, which eventually got the attention of director Kathryn Bigelow. Knowing that she had something worth showing to audiences, Kathryn got the funding and green light for the difficult shoot of The Hurt Locker, filmed in Jordan and Kuwait. A year later, after making several rounds in the film festival circuit in 2008, Summit Entertainment picks up the distribution rights and released it in theaters during the crowded blockbuster summer of 2009. Unfortunately, like most Iraq War movies, it literally bombs at the box office. However, The Hurt Locker was given a second life during the recent awards season, as the majority of critics deemed it as one of the best films of the year. So naturally, this gave The Hurt Locker some added attention. Now with 9 Oscar nominations and several Guild Awards under its belt, The Hurt Locker is gaining momentum. The Hurt Locker is an intense, realistic account of the ever-present danger of the Explosion Ordnance Disposal Unit in post-invasion Iraq, tasked with disarming bombs littered throughout the city of Baghdad. This particular film focuses on one specific EOD group, headed by roguish bomb disposal expert Sergeant William James, played by Jeremy Renner, always the man in charge to locate and defuse bombs. While the pressure of dismantling bombs oddly gives James a sense of joy and thrill, his comrade, Sergeant J.T. Sanborn, played by Anthony Mackie, and Specialist Owen Eldred, played by Brian Geraghty, feel that they are playing too close to death, especially with Sergeant James' reckless behavior. Tensions between the three mounts, admissions throughout the war zone of Iraq continue, and we, the audience, are forced to witness the third-person view of the fate of mortality that surrounds these soldiers. If Avatar weren't in the picture, The Hurt Locker would have won the big prize in a cakewalk. If critics and moviegoers were asked to name the one war film that defined the first decade of the new millennium, The Hurt Locker would be in the majority of opinions. The Hurt Locker is simply filmmaking and storytelling at its most gripping and intense. Usually I would explain in detail why a film is as good as it is, but I want to actually show you a scene that I think best describes the type of filmmaking you're about to experience.
Yeah, laying on the charge. Nice and sweet. Coming back.
Twenty-five meters, roger that.
Put your shot, 2 o'clock, dude has a phone!
Why is Eldridge running? Come on, guys, talk to me!
Drop the phone! Drop your phone!
Hey, bro!
I can't get a shot!
Damn. That's intense. This is only a short clip of the first scene in The Hurt Locker, and just from seeing that, you know you're in for a powerful ride. And it never lets up either. The three main characters, James, Sanborn, and Eldridge, are the only people we'll ever get to truly know throughout the story, and as the days count down to the rotation, I am at the edge of my seat, biting my nail in constant fear that certain death is just around the corner. It takes great writing, superb direction, and credible performances to pull off that feeling of dread and intensity, and thankfully the film pulls off all three. Usually modern war films aren't highly regarded to have many noteworthy performances in writing, as they are usually downplayed as an ensemble piece and directorial showboat, but I think these two elements make for a very underrated part of any good film. Just because the acting is subtle and realistic and not showy and Oscar bait doesn't necessarily make it less worthy. Just because the script doesn't follow the traditional three-act structure and contain quotable dialogue doesn't make for anything less than an outstanding screenplay. Sometimes less is more, which is why I'm glad the Academy finally has some ball and nominate Jeremy Renner for Best Actor and Mark Bull for Best Original Screenplay. For such an understated performance, Renner does leave a lasting impact on you. And because of his authentic to real-life acting, he makes for a fascinating character to watch. Bull, wrote Sergeant James, is one of those badass, reckless, don't-follow-the-rules type soldiers who you just can't help but be curious as to why he is the way he is, especially with the many close encounters of death that keep knocking on his door. He's always at the center point of the many intense scenes that the film can conjure up, so you're basically hoping he'd be alive to finally explain about himself. But I also think that co-star Anthony Mackie to be just as great as Renner. Mackie's Sergeant Sanborn as a no-nonsense man of honor makes for just an interesting character, if not more so, than Sergeant James. He has a hard-nosed sense of leadership, but shows a bit of emotional fragility that can break down any tough soldier, which makes for a more three-dimensional character. Mackie shows off those range very well, and it's shock that this guy doesn't get any Best Supporting Actor mentions. These two characters have opposite viewpoints on how to handle threats and insurgency, and provide the story's internal conflicts amid the external danger. But of course, the one thing that makes everything works about the film is the stellar direction by Kathryn Bigelow. The pacing, the shot selection, the consistency of the atmosphere, it's all Bigelow's. I don't think I've ever been surprised by how The Hurt Locker unveils itself as it did, as I take all of the credit to her memorable work. In fact, just watching this film, it's hard to believe that a woman even directed it. Yes, I know it's sexist, but honestly, for such a masculine, hard-edged movie, you would never expect a traditionally feminine director to be the one calling the shots. Which is why Bigelow is the award season darling this year. If there's one sure thing to beat James Cameron for Best Director this year, it has to be Bigelow. And before you guys mention it, yes, she happens to be the ex-wife of James Cameron. But seriously, I don't want to elaborate that backstory into the review. Bigelow is the fourth woman director ever to be nominated for Best Director. But unlike the previous three, Bigelow has a very decent shot of winning the damn thing, which would be a historical milestone. But the only reason why she picked for the winning isn't because she just happens to be a woman, it's because she deserved it. No other film this year pulls off the level of intensity and just overall awesomeness of genius filmmaking than The Hurt Locker, and Bigelow is the key component of all the thing that works. So there you go, folks. The Hurt Locker just plain rocks. The writing, the acting, the sound design, the editing, the environment, the direction, everything comes together magnificently. It's a technically superb film as well as an artistic achievement. Will it be Avatar for Best Picture? Well, it certainly had the credibility. It may not have made as much money as Avatar did, that's for sure, but that's never a way to discredit a film. Besides, if it wins, it will be the lowest-grossing Best Picture winner ever, which is a milestone in itself. In the future, The Hurt Locker will be regarded as one of the best historical war drama ever to be released in theaters. Sure, not many people have seen it in theaters, but thanks to word of mouth and award recognition, they will have plenty of time to see what's the fuss about on DVD. There's no better way to say it, but The Hurt Locker is an experience you must see.